Hi, everyone, and welcome to this week's Language Clinic. You may have noticed things look a little bit different. I'm wearing a different shirt. No, we're experimenting this week with the camera like this. So let me know how it goes. Let me know how it looks, if everything looks okay to you, and if everything is working okay for you. This should make it better for you on your phone, but let us know. Anyway, my name's Neil, and I'm here every week to answer all of your questions about learning English, whether it's grammar, vocabulary, skills, exam information, anything to do with that. You can ask me in the comments, and I'll try and answer as many questions as I can. Let's start with hopefully everyone saying hello and telling me where you're watching from. It's always nice to know where you are and know who's here. How long I am here for will depend on you, on how many questions you ask and, you know, how much I like your questions, to be honest. I could be here for 30 minutes. I could be here for 45 minutes. I could even be here for 1 hour if you have lots of questions, but it's up to you. So the best thing to do is to get started asking your questions as soon as possible so I can decide if I like them or not. Okay, let's see. Okay, so we've got people joining us already from Italy, from Hong Kong, from the Netherlands, from Egypt, Myanmar, Ecuador. Excellent. So we're going all the way from Latin America right the way to Southeast Asia at the moment. That's great. From Vietnam, from Egypt, and from Japan. Japan is as far east as we've ever gone, I think, so in this. So that's great. Nice to see you here. Okay. So as I said, any questions that you have about anything at all, there are, you know, you've probably heard the expression, there are no stupid questions. And that's absolutely true. Never be afraid to ask questions, no matter how small or how silly even you might think it is. If there's anything you're not sure about, anything that you would like help with, just ask. And if I can help, I'll try. If not, we'll try later. Okay. Okay, so let's get started with some questions that we've had already in the group and the page and so on and different like that. First question is from Jamal, a nice easy one for me to start with. What's the difference between a lot of and lots of? Well, let's turn this around because, like I said, we've got people from all over the world watching us at the moment and more joining us all the time from Syria, Philippines, Mexico, Hungary, and lots more. Let me ask you the question. Jamal is asking, what is the difference between a lot of and lots of? Can you tell me in the comments, anyone, what's the difference? Is there a difference? I should really start speaking soon to tell you, because otherwise we're just going to sit here uncomfortably looking at each other, waiting. But no, I trust you. Tell me what you think. A lot of, lots of. Is there a difference? What is the difference? Okay. Ween Ween is saying, I think they're the same. And I really have to learn to read Cyrillic because I can't say this name. I'm sorry. But this person says lots of is more informal. Diana is saying there's not any difference. Etas in Ong is saying, I think it's the same, can use uncountable and uncountable. That's absolutely correct. Okay, so going back to Jamal's question, a lot of and a lots of, it's got nothing to do with countable or uncountable. So that's one thing to forget about straight away. You can use it with countable and uncountable nouns. I have a lot of rice. I have a lot of friends. Okay, rice is uncountable. Friends are countable. So there's no difference there. The people who said about formality, that's the only difference. So you can use it with anything. Countable, uncountable, doesn't matter. But a lot of is a little bit more formal. Okay, you can use a lot. You can use it in every context. You can use it in writing to a friend. You can use it in writing for work. You can use it in an essay. You can use it in a formal report. Anywhere. A lot of is kind of neutral, and you can use it in more formal English too. Lots of is more informal. So you could say to your friend, I've got lots of time, let's do something. Okay, that's fine. Or in an informal email or message to a friend, lots of. Even more informal, we have, if we go further, we have some things like loads of. Oh, I have loads of time. That's a very informal way to say lots of. And at the other end, we can be more informal, but it gets a little more complicated when we talk about a lot of. We can talk about a great deal of to mean a lot of, for example, in a more formal way. Okay. And then there are lots of other more formal expressions that can go into that. But some of them are countable, uncountable. So I'm not going to talk about them now. I think I've answered Jamal's question. No difference in meaning. One is a bit more formal, can use everywhere. One is a bit less formal. Keep it for informal conversation or informal writing with your friends. Okay, lots of questions come in already, so let's take a look at them. I've got a big long explanation here from Yulia, so I'm going to share it because thank you for taking all the time to write this. Lots is plural and a slightly more informal phrase with the same meaning. Exactly. And then Yulia gives some examples. Okay. So let's move on to some questions that we had. Today is our day for things that don't have much difference. Okay, I hope we're going to get onto ones that have bigger differences. Van Tatran is saying, can you help me to differ between each other and one another? They helped each other after the accident. They helped each other after the accident. They helped one another. There's really no difference there in the meaning and in the use of that. Now there are some subtle differences, and I'll maybe explain those to you in the comments after, because it would take, we spent a lot of time with a lot of, so it would take a little bit of time. I'll maybe put some details in about that in the comments for you later. Okay. Question about IELTS now from Etazin Ong. I want to know how much IELTS score needed to study in London. Okay, for anyone who's interested in IELTS and in studying in the UK, it's not about the geography. It's not about that it's in the UK or that it's in London. It's about the institution and the course of study that you want to follow. Different schools, colleges, universities have different IELTS requirements. And within those schools, colleges, or universities, different courses can have different IELTS requirements. So, for example, if you want to go and study someplace, on average, they range between 6 and 7. So some for university courses. So some university courses will ask for 6, some might ask for 6.5, some might ask for 7, and a few ask for 7.5. Okay, especially when it's more language-based study, things like journalism, for example, or law, you might often find that they will ask for a higher score, 7.5. But on average, the range is between 6 and 7 for university-level study. If you're studying at the level before university, let's say a pre-university course or some preparation course for a further course of study, that's sometimes 5.5 for that, sometimes even 5. Okay, so really what you have to do is you have to identify what course you want to study, then look at the schools, colleges, or universities that offer that course, and then check their language requirements. And you can find that for the same course, one university might ask for 6, another university might ask for 7. Okay, it depends. So you have to check on a case-by-case basis. There's no one figure for that, for study in the UK. Okay. Ali Elmasri's got a question. Do we say my older brother or my elder brother? That's a good question. And again, technically, there are reasons why you would use elder. But in reality, in modern English now, it's actually quite uncommon to hear people talk in conversation about my elder brother. It happens. And, you know, older people like me may still do it. But it's becoming less and less frequent. And in American English, very infrequent with that. So really, I would just say stick with my older brother, because you can use it in all situations, at all times. Everyone will understand what you mean. Almost no one will say, don't you mean elder? You might find someone will say that at some point, but just ignore them. Okay. Let's keep looking at the questions. Okay, a little message from Edward here saying, you have a different camera, but as you mentioned earlier, this video fits for smartphones. Yes, that's my test. I just want to know if it works better, because I know that most of you, like almost 80% of you, watch on your phone. So, you know, the bad side is that it means my head is even bigger. So, you know, I'm sorry for that, but I think it should make it easier for you to concentrate and focus. Okay. Right. Thanks for all the great questions. There's so many. Oh, okay. It looks like I could be here for an hour. Okay. Mustafa's asking, is this a live video or recorded? Well, I think since I just displayed your question, I think I've answered it as well at the same time. I'm live. I'm here. Okay. Okay. So many questions. Mustafa's shared some useful information about the applying for a UK visa, which is correct. If you're applying for a visa for IELTS, going back to the IELTS course, it depends what kind you're applying for. There is a minimum level for that and so on. But all the information you need, you will find by checking the school, college, or university that you want to apply for. Right. I have to go back up because there's so many questions. Okay. Takibas Hayat is asking, how to improve my essay writing and composition? It's a good question. I obviously, you know, if I could improve your writing skills in 5 minutes here, I would be a millionaire, and you know, we'd all be very happy. So I can't tell you the complete answer very quickly, but I can give you some information and some links and some resources to help you with that. Basically, writing is for many people is the most difficult skill to develop, and very often it's the one that people spend the least time practicing. And when you think about your daily life, that's probably true in your own language as well. Maybe you have a job where you have to do a lot of writing. Maybe you're a student and you have to do lots of essays. But for most of us, writing is not the biggest part of our day. You know, some emails perhaps, but the rest of the time we're speaking, we're reading, we're listening, we're doing other things. So writing is perhaps one of the most difficult skills, but also the one that people often get the least practice in. So the first thing to do is to increase the importance of writing in your daily routine, is to make sure that you spend a little time each day or every 2 days writing in English. And it doesn't have to be essays or anything very long. It could just be short notes to yourself. It could be a diary, a journal. It could be one of my favorites. I love writing reviews on Google. Every time I go to a restaurant or a cafe and I enjoy it, I write a review every time. And it means that I get a really high score as a Google reviewer. which makes me happy too. But, you know, if I have a good experience, I always just write a short thing to say how much I enjoyed it, why, and to recommend things for other people. If I have a bad experience, I write a really bad review and really explain everything that was wrong. And, you know, that makes me happy, but it also means that I'm practicing writing every single day or every day that I go to a cafe or restaurant. So you could try something like that. Joining in our social media groups, join on Facebook, on Instagram, you know, on our YouTube channel, any place. Just commenting, watching and commenting and sharing your ideas. That's fantastic writing practice. And it's not like work. You know, you're telling people what you think. It's nice. All of these things, building writing into your daily life is very, very important. And then setting aside some time to practice more formal writing skills, like you're asking about essay writing, composition writing, stories or articles, things like that. The best thing to do with that is to visit our website. Our website has a whole section which you can find, as you can see there, on listening, reading, writing, and speaking. And it has activities for you to practice at every level, from beginner, elementary, right up to advanced. So you can choose the level and you can choose the type of thing you want to practice. If you want to practice essays, there are lots of essay practice activities there. If you want to practice emails, there's formal emails, informal emails, job applications, cover letters, letters to complain, all of these things. And if you just work through them, look at the example, look at the model of a good essay, then do the exercises to practice, and then write your own answer and check it and compare it. It will help you tremendously. So two things, basically, as I say, try and practice writing as much as possible in just natural life, online, reviews, journal, whatever works for you, and then practice a couple of times a week, let's say, a specific task, an essay or a story or an article using our website. Okay. It's just started. I don't know how good my microphone is, so I don't know if you can hear, but it's just started a big thunderstorm and rain here. I'm in Bratislava in Slovakia, and my windows are open. So I might start to panic in a minute if the rain gets really, really heavy. But there's thunder and lightning and rain happening outside. Javed Ahmed is saying, please share the link. No problem. I will do that. And we have watching us at the moment in our Facebook group. Sally is watching and answering your comments. And on Facebook and YouTube, Tina is there answering your comments as well. But just in case, I will add the comment as well just now. There, I've just shared the link in the comment, so you'll find it there. Okay, for the writing practice. I may not be able to hear you soon because the rain is really loud. Eight has in on is saying writing is more difficult than speaking. Honestly, that's true for, you know, 90% of people, I think. So don't worry about that. Everyone that doesn't have any physical problem to prevent them learns to speak and starts to speak. Not everyone learns to write. You know, learning to write is something that is a special skill that you have to start learning at school when you're older, and it takes years to become a good writer in your own language. So, you know, in a second language like English, of course it's going to be difficult. Don't worry, just keep practicing. Okay. Khalid Gaffer's question is that he's, I think he's asking, can you imagine it? Can you picture it? Is there a difference? Again, no, really not. Picture it is a little bit, again, maybe slightly more informal. And maybe it suggests a different type of imagination, in that maybe you're suggesting, you know, can you visualize it? Can you see it in your mind? But really, the meaning is exactly the same. Can you picture it? Can you imagine it? We would use these interchangeably. He got you know, he was late for class. He didn't bring his book, and then he fell asleep. Can you picture it? Can you imagine it? It doesn't matter which one you use. Okay. Okay. Bunch of questions there. Hold on. There's lots of strange comments that I'm not quite understanding. Manuel, you'll have to explain to me. I think I was nearly over the summit. Well, I was nearly over the summit when it started to rain. I'm guessing this is probably a reply or a reaction to someone else's comment, but I have no idea what you mean. So you can tell me about that, okay? Lots of people saying, how can I improve my speaking? Basically, I'm not going to spend a long time on that because we speak about that every week. And if you go back and watch some of our earlier language clinics, all of the recordings are here on Facebook and YouTube. You'll find lots of links, lots of answers, lots of information about that. Basically, the answer is similar to writing. You have to practice it as much as possible. So you have to practice, find a way to practice, if not every day, then at least as often as you can with friends, colleagues, classmates, family, anyone. It can be online like this, it can be face-to-face, doesn't matter, but practice is everything. So try to just make time to speak in English. And of course, to prepare for that, you can practice your listening and your reading to learn more vocabulary and work on your grammar to make sure that you know how to say the things you want to say. So there's lots of practice that will help your speaking, but really the only way to improve your speaking is by actually speaking. So check out our speaking skills section on the website as well for more on that. Okay, another kind of general question that we go into, how to improve your vocabulary. It's really not that difficult, honestly. It might seem that way, but if you do it systematically and really, you know, pay attention to it, it's not that difficult. Because if you practice, like I said a minute ago, every day, just a little, 15 minutes, 20 minutes, reading or listening or watching something in English that you enjoy, that you're interested in, and that you like, every single day, you will find vocabulary in that reading text, that video, that podcast, whatever you listen to. There will always be some new vocabulary or vocabulary used in a different way. So there will always be something that you can take from it, check, and then practice using. So the skill, the challenge, is the selection part, like I said there. Don't try to understand everything. Don't try to remember everything. Don't look up everything in a dictionary or put it into Google Translate. Choose just a few things that you think are important or useful or that you can use. Just a few. Check them, make a record of them, and then practice using them as soon as possible. Either speak with your friends using them, or speak to yourself, record yourself on your phone. Doesn't matter, but just practice using them when you're speaking. So if you find some new vocabulary about football, for example, then practice talking about football and try to use the new vocabulary as soon as possible. Not 1 week later, but the same day or the next day. Okay? And then keep going back. Try to use it in writing then. Try to write something using it. Then wait a week or more and then have another conversation about football or write something else about football and use that new vocabulary again. And if you get it right, you can check it. If you get it right, great. Keep using it. If you get it wrong, check your notes again. Check the example that you recorded. Check where you found it. Check that you've used it correctly. And then try again and keep trying to use it. And if you do that every day, I mean, you know, just add a few words every day, a few expressions, a few phrases, a few things that you think are really useful that you can actually make use of in your real life, then you'll find that very quickly you can start learning more and you can add more. And your vocabulary will become better, you'll become more confident, you'll feel more able to talk about different topics, and the whole process will become easier for you because you'll be training yourself to do this. And that's it. That's really all there is to it. Okay. Let's move on. I'm scrolling through hundreds of comments now to get to the very end to see the most recent one. Okay. It seems that Julia and Manuel are having a conversation but separated by lots of things here. So I'm not quite sure. Okay, Gavi's saying they can hear the thunderstorm. Yeah, it's quite loud. Uh-huh. I like this question. What's the website that can help me to learn to speak English? We have several. If you're looking for free resources to help you practice, then our Learn English website is the best place in the world to go. Honestly, it's the best website that there is for learning English. So if you go to the Learn English website, you'll find everything you need. Reading, writing, speaking, listening, videos, grammar, everything. Okay? If you want to take a course, if you want to pay for like a course, an online course, and to actually join other students in a class online, then you can visit our English Online website. And they have different options. They have group classes that you can join with our British Council teachers, or they have one-to-one classes where you can just speak you and the teacher, or they also have self-study classes where you can do lots of practice and activities to help yourself and work through the different levels without a teacher for that. Not completely without a teacher. When you're in the self-study classes, you can join some weekly like webinar things with teachers about for grammar and so on. So there's lots to help you there. So basically, our Learn English website or our English Online website are the place to start for any of those. Okay, yeah. Alisa Kotzi is saying, now I can hear the thunderstorm as well. Yes. Lucky I'm not afraid of thunder and lightning. My cat, not so happy, but that's another story. Okay, good question. A detailed grammar question from Asfak Malik here. I saw this usage today. His birthday would have marked. Okay, what does it mean, would have, plus the past participle here? What this means is that he's unfortunately dead. Okay, it means that it would have marked if, you know, it's basically, it's like the second half of a third conditional sentence, but we don't need the if part. So it's like, if he had lived, his birthday would have marked the 100th anniversary of something happening or something like that. Would have marked meant it would have been a reminder of, or it would have been on the same day as, or it would have shown some achievement. But the would have means that it didn't happen, basically. Okay, so his birthday would have marked, but it did not because he's no longer alive. Okay, so we can use that for anything in the past that didn't happen. Somebody could ask, why didn't you come to my party on Friday? And you can say, I would have come, but I was really busy with work. Okay, same thing again. It's in the past. It didn't happen because I was busy. So I would have come, but I was busy. I'm sorry. You know, could be an accident, you know, it could be could have, you know, it's like you should drive more carefully, you could have killed me. Okay, again, it's saying you didn't kill me, I'm still here, but you did something stupid, you drove very badly, and at that time it could have, in the past there was a possibility that you could have killed me. Okay, so that's basically what it's saying. His birthday would have marked means that it would have marked something. It would have been a special occasion of something, but it was not because he's no longer alive. Okay. This is a good question from Facebook user. Please, can you explain for us intonation? The answer to that is yes. But unfortunately, the answer is today, no. I think we'll have to have a special class on that, in a special live session on that, because it's too much to go into at the moment. There's a lot to think about with intonation. Maybe Tina or Sarah can share a link. We have a very good blog in our British Council Voices blog on how students can practice intonation. It's worth sharing, it's worth reading. If they can't find it, I'll share it a little bit later. But intonation is very important. It's very important because it affects the way that the person listening to you understands and hears you, how they feel about what they're saying, and it can affect the meaning. It can cause confusion if you get it wrong, or it can upset people or even make them angry if you get it wrong. So it's very important, and it's very important as well for things like just to show that you're interested or you're listening or to show that you're surprised. Intonation comes into so many things, and it's very important. But if I started talking about it now, we would be here until nighttime. So I'll put it to one side. We'll share a link with you to help you with that. And maybe we'll talk about it in one of our grammar classes or one of our other live sessions in future. Okay. Javed Ahmed saying, I know a lot of vocabulary, but I don't know how to use it. Okay. There's two problems there. Number one, if you know a lot of vocabulary, it depends what know means. Know there, if you don't know how to use it, then what that really means is I can understand a lot of vocabulary. Okay, but until you can use it yourself, I wouldn't say that I know it definitely. I know it when I can recognize it, when I can understand it, and when I can use it correctly myself. So if by know you mean that you can understand, you know, when you listen, when you read, when you have conversations and everything, that's fantastic. That's really good work. That means that you're two-thirds of the way there. But you need to finish that last third, which is using it yourself, okay? And to know how to use it, again, comes back to practice. When you learn it, make sure that you learn it in context. Make sure you learn it with some examples, that you learn the other words that go together with it, before, after, maybe whole phrases or even whole sentences that use it. And then you have to try to use them. You have to make yourself use them, either speaking or writing or both. Okay, so maybe if you arrange them by topic, for example, then you can try writing about some topic and try to use the vocabulary that you're not sure of, the vocabulary that you understand but don't feel comfortable using. And then when you do that, the more that you use it actively yourself, the time that it takes for you to think of it will get shorter and shorter. It will become more natural. It will become automatic for you after some time. And then it won't be a problem. And then you can say, I know all of that vocabulary perfectly. Okay, so again, it's just practice and work. So keep checking your vocabulary records. If there are words that you, or I say words, I mean words, expressions, phrases, whatever, that you've recorded and that you like and that you want to use, you have to make that next step and use them. And, you know, the situation is not always there in real life to use them, so maybe you have to create a situation. Maybe you have to have a conversation with a friend about some topic, or maybe you have to practice writing a short paragraph about some topic, or maybe you have to record yourself speaking for 1 minute without stopping about some topic and try to use that vocabulary in that 1 minute. All of these things will help you, okay? But it all comes down to practice, practice, practice. It's always three. So let's go for four. Practice, 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 okay? Okay, I'm not quite sure how to pronounce this first name, if it's Keek or Queeque or Kikwe. It's a nice name. I like it, but I don't know how to say it exactly. But one of these is right. You can tell me in the comments. Is it okay to say don't you worry instead of don't worry? That's a good question. Don't you worry. Personally, I would just stick with don't worry. I don't see any reason to add in the you. Sometimes in English, when you say don't you worry, it's actually not a good thing. Sometimes we use it as like a threat when we want to say something bad to someone. We're saying, don't you worry, I won't forget. Or don't you worry, I'll see you later. It's emphasizing that more. And so that's the first thing that comes to my mind when I hear don't you worry. But maybe that's just, you know, my problem. But it's not wrong. Don't you worry, it'll be fine. It's absolutely fine. You know, you want to help somebody in your office and say, don't you worry, I'll get it later. It's absolutely correct. There's no problem with it. But it's not necessary. So, you know, do it if you want. If you feel more comfortable saying it, it's fine. But there's no need to say it. That's basically what I'm saying. Unless you want to emphasize that you're specially directing it at this person. Would it be okay to use it in my essay or speaking part of the... Absolutely. It's grammatically correct. It's, you know, it's correct vocabulary. There's absolutely nothing wrong with it in any way. No one would penalize you anywhere for using it. I would, you know, and I'm not saying don't use it. It's absolutely fine. All I'm saying is it's not necessary most of the time. So, you know, why use an extra word if you don't have to? Okay. Which some people might say is ironic considering how much I speak, but that's another story. Okay. Julia's just making a comment here saying non-native speakers grapple with listening most of the time, also owing to short grip. Yeah, we've spoken about speaking and we've spoken about writing so far, but listening is absolutely essential. You know, you can't have a conversation without good listening skills. You certainly can't take part in online classes or lectures. You can't watch movies. You can't listen to songs. You can't, you know, listen to podcasts. You can't do any of that if you don't develop your listening skills. So all four skills are equally important. The thing about listening that's different from writing and speaking, though, is that you can practice listening literally as much as you want to. You know, there's so much out there to practice with. There's thousands and thousands of hours of free resources, YouTube videos, TikTok videos, Instagram videos, TV shows, podcasts, websites like our Learn English website with hundreds of different listening activities at different levels from beginner to advanced. You know, you can practice as much listening as you want. You don't need anyone else to help you. You don't need anyone else to listen to you or read what you say. You can do it alone on a desert island, at the top of a mountain, anywhere. So listening, like reading, is great for that. If you're finding you have problems with listening, then really all you have to do is make more time, choose what you listen better, perhaps, so it's things that you really want to listen to and understand and that are not too difficult. And then just practice, practice, practice. My three words of the day. Okay. Let's see what other questions. Okay. I was explaining what I was asking earlier. I was trying to explain almost and nearly. Okay, good. Then your example was excellent, and that was a very good explanation, and I understand it perfectly. I just missed the first part that explained to me what you were doing. Yes. Okay, very good. I'm not going to talk about this one much. It's beef to cub. Again, it's the same advice as before. There are big differences between formal and informal writing. There are differences in the vocabulary. We use shorter, more frequent words in informal writing than formal writing. There's difference in the sentence construction. We use shorter, simpler sentences in informal writing, sometimes just one word. Great. Okay. Things like that. Okay. In informal writing, you have to learn how to join your sentences together to make more complex sentences. So there's differences in grammar as well. There's differences in, I mentioned vocabulary, but there's differences in things like linking words. You know, when we're using informal English, we just use and, but, so, usually. In formal English, you learn all these other words like therefore, moreover, additionally, and so on, you know, things like that. So there's a lot of differences. It's not something that's just one or two things. It's like almost like two different languages in some way. So you do have to learn it, and you do have to learn what the differences are and when to use them. And our website, again, as I mentioned before, our writing skills section in our website has activities at every level, from A1 to C1, and every type of activity you can see there. Maybe I can just make this a little bigger. It's maybe a bit too small for you. You can see there we've got everything like covering email. That's going to be formal. CV is going to be formal. Letter of complaint will be formal. A report will be formal. But then we've got things like an informal email to a friend and stuff like that that go into that. So if you go through these activities and practice with them, then you will learn what the differences are between formal and informal emails, and you will learn how to write a good one yourself. Okay? Okay, I have a couple more questions coming up here. You know, when I said when I said it could be any time from 30 minutes to 1 hour, of course I was being optimistic, because there are always so many questions. It's always going to be longer. Okay, Van Tat Tran is asking, which one is correct writing between foreign direct investment and direct foreign investment, FDI and DFI? FDI is the common way to talk about this. We talk about foreign direct investment. And if you Google, you should see that there is a difference in the number of hits and the number of frequency between those. And you should see that foreign FDI is the widely used abbreviation and the widely used word form. Okay. What else have we got? There's so many questions. Just choosing them is more difficult than answering them. Okay. I love this question from Elena Jimenez, because it's one that we spoke about recently, and it's one that we have coming up in one of our mini English lessons on YouTube. I spoke about this last week. What is the reason shall is only used with we and I? Okay, there's two things I'm going to say here. It's historic. It's to do with the historic development of English, and it's really not important, okay? As you say, historically, with the first person, singular and plural, I shall, we shall was the correct form, and will was used with second and third person forms within that. But actually, shall is almost never used now in English except for invitations and offers. Things like, shall we dance? Shall we go? Shall we go now? Shall I open the window? Shall we wait until tomorrow? That's, you know, it's really only used in kind of the question form like this for things like offers or suggestions. Otherwise, especially in American English, but also in British English, will is used for I and we as well. But, you know, when we're speaking, we contract it to I'll anyway, so it really doesn't matter. It's like I'll see you tomorrow. I'll send the report first thing in the morning. We'll talk about it at the next meeting, okay? So basically, you know, sometimes we use shall for other things as well, you know, like almost joking, like ironically, it's like I shall, but no. But generally, just, you know, you can stick with will for every circumstance accept the offers and invitations that, you know, shall I open the window? Shall we go tomorrow? Things like that, okay? So don't worry about it, is really my message to you. And as for the why, I can share a link that will explain the historic development of this and stuff, but yeah, I think there's probably more important things you can focus on. Okay. Okay, Medat Kasem is saying, English has become an international language. I think we can all agree on that. And another thing that I'll share in the links later is the British Council have just produced a fantastic report that's taken years to develop and years to work on, called The Future of English, which looks, it's a complete free book that you can download that looks at the current situation of English in the world, the history of developments over recent years, and looks forward to the future as to what will happen, you know, in terms of world language, technology, business, everything to do with that. Okay, but Medat's saying, I think it isn't obligatory to speak the same as a native speaker, but fluency is the important matter. Do you agree with me? I think that there's two parts to that. You, first of all, you say it isn't obligatory to speak the same as a native speaker. The answer to that, my answer to that is 100% yes. You're absolutely right. It's not necessary. It's in fact, you know, in some ways, it can even be a bad thing. There are actually academic studies that show that non-native speakers, that speakers of English as a second or third language, communicating together, actually are often more successful and more precise in things like business, because they work to make sure that they understand each other and adapt what they're saying within that, than communication sometimes between native English speakers and non-native English speakers. And the vast majority of communication in English as a world language is between non-native speakers of English. You know, the vast majority, billions of people worldwide, are using English every day to speak to other people who are not British or American or Australian or Irish or whatever. Okay, so absolutely, it's not necessary. What is necessary is for your English to be the best it can be. Now, you say that fluency is the important matter. Absolutely, fluency is very important, but accuracy is also important. You want your vocabulary and your grammar to be accurate as well. I mean, imagine if you were a doctor and you were communicating with another doctor on some life or death situation. Being fluent is good. It means you can speak together comfortably without long pauses, and you can, you know, be quite confident exchanging ideas. But accuracy is very important too. If you use the wrong word, or if you use perhaps the wrong tense, or, you know, the wrong sentence construction, you might give completely the wrong message to the other doctor, and disaster. So, yeah, fluency is very important, and I would always encourage people to focus on developing fluency first as part of their process of development within that. But, yeah, you also want to make sure that your grammar and vocabulary are accurate and correct, so that your message is clear, concise, correct, and that the person you're speaking to has no problems in understanding and responding. But the first point, absolutely, just stick with that. Yes, there's absolutely, it's not obligatory, it's not necessary, it's not even important, I would say, to speak the same as a native speaker. Speak as the best English speaker you can be. That's all. Okay. Okay. I like that we're getting some nice difference between questions today. I like these. Often there really isn't much difference or any difference. So, you know, that's my answer. But sometimes there are some interesting little differences. So Shah Muhammad Saif Bukhti is saying, what's the difference between I'm home and I'm at home? Normally, okay, if we say I'm home, normally normally we would use that in a context where we're speaking to someone else or telling someone else the information. So you might come home to your family, open the door and say, "Hello, I'm home." Okay? You wouldn't say, "Hello, I'm at home." That would be weird. I'll tell you why in a minute. Okay? You might leave someone late at night and say, "I'll call you when I get home." And you might phone them up and say, "Okay, I'm home." That's it. Okay? Home there is an adverb. It's saying where you are. Where are you? I'm home. Okay? But it's used in that communication context. It's used to tell somebody, "I'm here." It's actually like, "I'm here. I'm here. I'm home." Okay? I'm here, home, now. At home, the preposition at home, the meaning is basically the same. The place is the same, and you're in the place. So it's similar in that way. But it's used to describe your location in this. So you're saying, you know, "Where are you right now? I'm at home." It's not news that you've just arrived home, which is what I was just describing a minute ago. It's describing just a fact of physically where you are. I'm at home, okay? And so really the difference, you know, the difference in meaning is very small or almost nothing, but the difference in use is different. So "I'm at home" is just giving someone the information of where you are at that time, physically. "I'm home" is describing, is saying, okay, you've arrived home from somewhere, you're home now, you're here. Yay! Okay, that's the difference. I don't know if that's the best explanation in the world, but hopefully it will help. Okay. Let's move on. I think we've got time for one more question. Two more questions, because this one's going to be so short I can answer it in 10 seconds. "What are you doing? Is this grammatically right?" Yes, but it depends on the context. If you're asking about my job, it's wrong. That would be, "What do you do?" But if you're asking a question about some action, some activity happening right now, it's absolutely correct. What am I doing? I'm speaking to you. What am I doing? I'm answering questions. What are you doing? You're asking questions. Absolutely correct. No problem at all to ask about something that is happening right now, that's, you know, that's in process, that's happening at the moment. Okay. I think I'm almost done. I'm just trying to see if there's any more questions. Okay, question from Olemer. Bit difficult one there. What meaning does "up" add to a verb in general? Unfortunately, there is not one answer to that. It depends. It's a very frequent particle used in phrasal verbs, and you'll find it in hundreds of phrasal verbs, but what it adds to that phrasal verb is not always the same thing. And I can't really go into more detail about it here because I need to give some examples. It has different meanings. It depends on the phrasal verb. It depends on when it's, sometimes it's not a phrasal verb. Sometimes it's just used as a preposition. I'll give you some examples in the comments later. Okay. Okay, I'm going to finish with this last one, okay, because I like it. Well, I like them all. They're all excellent questions. But hold on just one moment. Talk among yourselves. I'll be with you in 1 second. Yes, Carmen, yes. Again, please check our Learn English website and especially check our takeielts.britishcouncil.org website. We'll share the link in the comments. We have hundreds of things to help you, ranging from free activities and free resources up to courses you pay for, where you can have one-to-one tutoring from a teacher for IELTS. Whatever you are looking for, we have. Okay. Where was I? Javed Ahmed saying, I think we can improve our learning by speaking, by joining a class. Absolutely. If it's possible for you, I strongly recommend everyone to join a face-to-face class, whether live, you know, in person or online. You know, nothing is better than having classmates to speak to and a teacher to help you. You can learn by yourself. You can learn perfectly by yourself. You can become the best English speaker in the world by yourself. But it's more fun, it's faster, and it's better for identifying the areas you need to work on and any problems you have and fixing them if you can have a teacher and classmates in a class to work with. It's not possible for everyone, and like I say, that's not a problem. You can still learn, but it might take a little bit longer, it might take a little bit more work, and it will definitely depend very much on your commitment and your dedication. But joining a class, absolutely, Javed. You know, if you can join a class, do it. That would be my advice to everyone. Okay. Where was I? I had that one last question. So yes, I really like this one. Okay. This is a nice question from Nguyen Thi Tu Hong. Can I say I can't help you now? You should do it yourself. I like this one because it shows something that we all have to be very careful of. Grammatically, there's nothing wrong with this sentence. The vocabulary is perfect. The grammar is perfect. Everything is correct in the sentence. But I would not recommend you to use this question. I would not recommend you to use this sentence. I'm imagining a situation where you work with the public. Could be that, you know, you work in, could be a restaurant, you could be a server in a restaurant, it could be a bank, you could be a bank assistant there, it could be a hotel, could be anything, any kind of work where you're dealing with a shop, any work where you're dealing with customers or the public and saying something. The problem with this sentence is that it's not very polite. The first part, no problem, I can't help you now. I would make that a little bit more polite by saying something first before that. We usually like to put what we call softeners in English. So you could say something like, I'm sorry, or you could say something like, sorry, or you could say, I'm afraid, you know, just like that. I'm afraid I can't help you now. That's okay. Just something to go first to show that, you know, you feel bad about not being able to help them. So I'm sorry, I'm afraid. That's all you need. You can put that before any negative, any bad news. I'm afraid we don't have any left. You know, I'm sorry, but we sold the last one. I'm sorry, but the hotel is full. Anything like that, just put it before your message. The second part is not polite at all. You should do it yourself in English. It's hard for me to explain why to you, but it's just rude. It just sounds like you're going, get lost, go away, do it yourself. I'm busy, you know, and then you go back to your phone and watching a TikTok video or something. That's what that's like if you say you should do it yourself. It's not a good structure to use for this. It might be better to say something like, I'm sorry, I can't help you now. Do you think you could try? Something like that. Do you think you could try to do it yourself? That makes it more polite. Or would it be possible for you to do it yourself? Or, you know, I think that, you know, let me think. I can't help you. I'm sorry, I can't help you now. Maybe don't even say do it yourself. Maybe say if there's a better message than that. Maybe, you know, if you can ask them to wait and maybe you can help them a little later, or if you can get someone else to help them, that might be good as well. I'm just thinking, you know, and let me think about a hotel for an example. You know, it's something like I'm in a hotel room and something's not working. The light needs changed or something like that. And I phone to reception and I say, my room is dark and I can't see anything. The light's broken. And you say, sorry, I can't help you now. Can you do it yourself? I would give you a one-star review on TripAdvisor after that. You know, so I'm trying to think for the context, maybe a hotel, a shop, something like that. Could you do it yourself? Maybe it's just a colleague at work. Maybe you just want to say, I can't help you now. Could you do it yourself? Even then, I would still want to say something like, maybe I can't help you now. I'll see if I can do something later. Or maybe after I finish this, I can have a look. Or what I said before, where you just say something like, would it be possible or could you try to do it yourself? Something like that. That would be okay. Okay. But so the basic message, I've said a lot of examples there. You'll have to go back and watch them again. But the basic message here is put something before saying no. Put something before you say, I can't help you. I'm sorry. I'm afraid. And put something before do it yourself. Try and say, maybe you could try it yourself. Or could you make it a question? Could you maybe try it yourself? Things like that, okay? All of these things, just making it a little longer, putting some words before the negative information will make it more polite, okay? That's my last question. I'm over time, even for 1 hour by 2 minutes, so now I have to go. Thank you all for coming. It's been great having all your questions. I will answer all the other questions in the comments later on. All the ones we missed, but I hope you enjoyed it. If you did enjoy it, well, let me know if the camera looked okay for you for a start, because it was a new camera. The rain has stopped, the thunder has stopped. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you got answers that were useful for you. I will see you next week. If you have any questions about English at any time between now and then, you can always write them on our Facebook page, on our YouTube channel, on our Instagram channel, in our Facebook group, okay? And someone, maybe me, maybe someone else, will answer you, okay? So don't be afraid, don't be shy, ask your questions. We love questions, okay? Right, bye for now. Got to go.